We, the congregation of Strathearn United Church, are situated on Treaty 6, traditional lands of the First Nations and the Métis people. Welcome to our worship here at Strathearn United Church, and it is hot. This is one of the reasons why maybe a little more casual. That is, and then from what I've been hearing, it's going to get warmer and warmer, so drink lots of fluids and try and find ways of staying cool. Draw your attention to, well, that's one of the announcements. I understand that there have been some technical issues in sending out the bulletin to folks, and so there's been a bit of a challenge for people to get the information from the church and the like. There are a couple of bits and pieces that we'll probably try again to make sure that folks get the information. One of the things that didn't go out was the minister's musings. Well, it went out, but I don't know who got it and who didn't. So I've got them with me just now, and I'll share them again. As I kind of shared in my, when I have my minister's musings, I share quite a bit of my stuff on my personal Facebook page and my personal Twitter page, and it's interesting how the folks who I follow and are my Facebook friends and the like, how they respond to my kind of church life, as it were. And it's always kind of a little disconcerting, especially when someone who I know is not part of that group, as it were, shares my stuff, and it's like, what's going on there? So what were my minister's musings this year, this week? Well, first of all, I have to confess, I enjoyed it just a little too much. As you may know, I'm Scottish. And as part of the genetic Scottish heritage is a distrust of bishops. It starts back to the Reformation period, even before there are aspects of some of the Celtic church that was not that enthusiastic of bishops. And so these musings were written in response to the recent actions by some bishops in the United States. So I'll just start reading them. Because I think they come very much to the heart of the matter. And the heart of the matter is, who gets to decide who can celebrate communion? And this is a question that's haunted the Christian faith throughout the ages. And it's a powerful illustration of the clash between the hope of the vision of the kingdom of God and the reality of what happens when the church becomes a tool to try and enforce power over others. In this case, the very public display of power, when an institution can declare, you can take part in communion and you can't. In other words, you, an institution that creates an exclusion, that you're somehow not worthy enough to be at the table. Now, you may have heard of the actions of a number of bishops in the United States who have decided that they have the authority to weaponize God's invitation to the table. In this case, to exclude politicians who do not adhere to a specific doctrine. Now, I'm not going to spend much time in the absolute hypocrisy of these bishops, but I will point out that there's not much reference to abortion in the Bible. In fact, some of the references in Scripture are actually fairly supportive of abortion. And they're also very clear, Jesus himself says not one word on the topic. Nothing. The point that strikes me about the actions of these bishops, which was actually just a kind of an interesting kind of aside in terms of hierarchy of power, the Vatican told them, don't do this. The Vatican said to these Catholic bishops, don't do this, you know, there's more important things for us to worry about. You know, for an institution that celebrates hierarchy, it doesn't like being told what to do by those higher than them. So there you go. The point that strikes me is how the actions of these bishops is a powerful witness to the world of the failure of Christianity to live up to the vision of radical inclusive love that is at the heart of the hope of the kingdom of God. A kingdom that is realized when people gather as equals in the presence of God and share a meal and a story. You want to know why Christians are perceived by so many people as sanctimonious, judgmental hypocrites? How are they supposed to respond when the leadership of one of the largest churches in North America decides that they have the power to exclude other people from the table of the Lord on a matter that is far more an issue of politics in the United States than religion. Why would you think otherwise? So, who does Jesus invite to the table? Anyone who hungers for hope. Anyone who is broken and yearns for healing. Anyone who is weary and hopes for a moment of rest in the company of others who will support them. Anyone who is lonely, seeking the presence of others who will welcome them. Anyone looking for strength to be able to be sorry. Anyone hoping to be free from the judgment of others. Anyone who wants reassurance that God is with us. If you want a concrete example of who Jesus is willing to serve communion to, remember that on the night he was going to be betrayed by Judas, he served Judas. So if Jesus could serve Judas, I think he would even serve a bunch of U.S. bishops who have the arrogance to believe that they know better than Jesus, who is worthy to take part in the celebration of the kingdom of God at this communion. Communion is not a privilege granted to a select group of those deemed worthy by the institutions of the church, whatever form it takes. And exclusion from communion is just as much a Protestant thing as it is a Catholic thing, so don't kid yourselves. Communion is a gracious invitation from God to lay down what separates us from one another and together share in a glimpse of a world that can be when we learn to serve one another and not judge one another. So that's my minister's musings for this week. And for those, you know, who read them, and you've got read them and here, listen, so it's in stereo. So let's just take a moment and prepare ourselves for worship. The church is not a group of people who believe all the same things. The church is a group of people caught up in the same story with Jesus at the center. Let us begin our worship with Your Hands, O Christ, Voices United 622. That's 622. Strong to heal and save, who draw and prayer of approach is the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 6, verses 9 to 13. Pray then in this way. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come. Your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we also have forgiven our debtors. And do not bring us to the time of trial, but rescue us from the evil one. Amen. Together let us join in a new creed. We are not alone. We live in God's world. We believe in God, who has created and is creating, who has come in Jesus, the Word made flesh, to reconcile and make new, who works in us and others by the Spirit. We trust in God. We are called to be the church, to celebrate God's presence, to live with respect in creation, to love and serve others, to seek justice and resist evil, to proclaim Jesus crucified and risen, our judge and our hope, in life, in death, in life beyond death. God is with us. We are not alone. Thanks be to God. Let us take a moment as we prepare to open our hearts to God. Our confessional psalm is Psalm 130, verses 1 to 6. Out of the depths I cry to you, O God. God, hear my voice. Let your ears be attentive to the voice of my supplications. If you, O God, should mark iniquities, God, who could stand? But there is forgiveness with you, so that you may be revered. I wait for God, my soul waits, and in God's word I hope. My soul waits for God more than those who watch for the morning, more than those who watch for the morning. The steadfast love of God never ceases. God's mercies never come to an end. Amen. Our next hymn is Psalm 91, On Eagle's Wings, Voices United, 808. That's 808.
Shine like the sun and hold you. A reading from the Gospel of Mark, chapter 5, verses 21 to 43. When Jesus had crossed again in the boat to the other side, a great crowd gathered around him, and he was by the sea. Then one of the leaders of the synagogue, named Jairus, came, and when he saw him, fell at his feet and begged him repeatedly, "My little daughter is at the point of death. Come and lay your hands on her so that she may be made well and live." So he went with him. And a large crowd followed him and pressed in on him. Now there was a woman who had been suffering from hemorrhage for 12 years. She had endured much under many physicians and had spent all the time she had, and she was no better, but rather grew worse. She had heard about Jesus and came up behind him in the crowd and touched his cloak, for he said, "If I but touch his clothes, I will be made well." Immediately her hemorrhage stopped, and she felt in her body that she was healed of her disease. Immediately aware the power had gone forth from him, Jesus turned about in the crowd and said, "Who touched my clothes?" And his disciples said to him, "You see the crowd pressing in on you. How can you say, 'Who touched me?'" He looked all around to see who had done it. But the woman, knowing what had happened to her, came in fear and trembling, fell down before him, and told him the whole truth. He said to her, "Daughter, your faith has made you well. Go in peace and be healed of your disease." While he was still speaking, some people came from the leader's house to say, "Your daughter is dead. Why trouble the teacher any further?" But overhearing what they said, Jesus said to the leader of the synagogue, "Do not fear, only believe." He allowed no one to follow him except Peter, James, and John, the brother of James. When they came to the house of the leader of the synagogue, he saw a commotion, people weeping and wailing loudly. When he had entered, he said to them, "Why do you make a commotion and weep? The child is not dead, but sleeping." And they laughed at him. Then he put them outside and took the child's father and mother and those who were with him and went in where the child was. He took her by the hand and said to her, "Talitha, come," which means, "Little girl, get up." And immediately the girl got up and began to walk about. She was 12 years of age. At this, they were overcome with amazement. He strictly ordered them that no one should know this and told them to give her something to eat. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
It was interesting when I was listening to Christine doing the scripture reading, one of the phrases she said, Tabitha said, which is in the Little Trouble Eyes. A couple of weeks ago, Jen was working on her podcast and she asked me what the meaning of this phrase was, and I explained it to her. I had to resist the temptation to go on about, well, what that meant and this kind of stuff. She says, I just wanted to know what the actual phrase meant. You can never stop me from rattling on. And now it's time for the sermon. You've been duly warned. Heroes, the heroes of the Gospel of Mark. Who are they? Well, obviously, Jesus is the obvious choice. His companions, well, not so much. One of the ongoing things about Mark is that it takes him quite a while to become heroic, shall we say. But there is another group of heroes, and frustratingly, of course, they're not unnamed. And these are the people who benefit from the healing miracles, or maybe not benefit, I'd say more part of the relationship that leads to the healing miracles. And in today's story, we truly hear a story of a hero. Why? Well, I think one of the things we have to work on in general in our society, just as we did in Mark, is what is our definition of a hero? Like, you know, what do we look for in a hero? And in the audience of Mark, it's comforting sometimes to know that we're still in the same boat. The audience of Mark would have listened to this story. And if someone had said to them, the unnamed woman who touched the cloak of Jesus, she's a hero too, they would have kind of like, what do you mean? How can she be a hero? We don't know her name. And that's actually quite significant, because in the culture of Jesus and many of the cultures, including the root cultures of our own, to know the name is to be a hero. That the main point of being a hero is you will live long enough in people's memories, that they will remember, you know, Conan the Barbarian or whatever. Now, the unfortunate reality is you will be remembered because of your deeds. And the way we have worked too often is deeds of violence, the celebration of warfare, where a person can be labeled as being great because they went out with a bunch of a few thousand of their mates and slaughtered their way through Asia Minor, the Central Asian Republics, as far as India and Pakistan. On the way, they slaughtered countless numbers of civilians as well as other soldiers. And then the fellow, I'm not going to mention his name because as far as I'm concerned, he's not a great person, decides to punish his army, his own army, just because they had had enough. So he marches them through a desert, slaughtering thousands of his own people, just because he was annoyed. And yet he is great. Yeah, great at killing people. The challenge for Mark is to show people that, yeah, we need heroes. There are heroes in our stories. And we need these heroes to change the world. But guess what? They don't have to go around killing people, large numbers of them. And also, there are consequences. It's an interesting connection between heroes that change the world through consequences. Even today, when we watch Hollywood movies and we watch the hero slaughtering thousands of people, we go, yeah, great, awesome. Especially if they do it in supposedly humorous ways, with the odd humorous phrase, oh, take that. Picture this. Imagine if we actually had some of the backstories of the people they slaughtered. Like one of the stormtroopers, just before the battle, opens up his lunchbox. There's a note from his daughter saying, I hope you do good, hope you have a good day, Dad or Mother. Or say the hero in the fantasy, whatever, slaughtered all the night watch, Before that, we see one of them opening up their, you know, a note from their wife. I hope we'll get together for our anniversary. You're a wonderful husband. We live in a society where expectations of heroes are shaped by our culture, and our culture celebrates violence and often shies away from the consequences of that violence. Now, fortunately, there are other shows, other ways, like, for instance, one of my favorite series of books is the Night Watch series of books by Terry Pratchett. He actually takes the people who get slaughtered by the hero and makes them the heroes of the story. And it's wonderful how they look at the world. They don't want half the kingdom. They want a pay raise. They want a dartboard for their office. Not the hand of the princess, though. They don't like her. Or Lord Dex in the Star Trek world. Like this. What does it mean to be the part of the Lord Dex crew in Star Trek? Yes, first contact's very important, but we don't do that. What we do is second contact, still pretty important. We get all the paperwork signed, make sure they're spelling the name of the planet right, and get to know where the good places to eat. You know, mundane stuff. But it's important, and they're heroes. I'm hoping one day for the Lord of the Rings version. I'm not sure what that would look like. I don't think anyone's in a great rush to find out the daily life of a bunch of orcs. But there are consequences to actions. And I use that as an example because it's an extreme example that when we identify with the hero, we identify with the way that makes us feel good without understanding the consequences of what's going on. And what we hear in today's story from the Gospel of Mark is a hero who acts. She doesn't think about what she's doing. She just wants to kind of make herself better. And then when she's confronted by the consequences of her actions, that's when she becomes the hero. In our culture, heroes avoid consequences. Consequences are for little people. What we hear in the Gospel of Mark is someone becomes a hero because they deal with the consequences. So what do we hear in this story? A powerful story of how someone becomes a hero of faith for her faith in Jesus. She has faith, you know. It's this kind of, it's weird. She has faith, but she doesn't want to jinx it. She knows Jesus will heal her, but she doesn't want to confront Jesus, and she's worried. Her society has probably been beaten up on her for so many years. She's a woman who deals with constant bleeding, therefore she's a sign of impurity. And in the world of Jesus, if something impure touches you, you become impure. So the rationale is probably going in this poor woman's head is, I want to be healed by Jesus, but I don't want to be blamed by others if I make Jesus impure by him touching me. So she kind of sneaks up on him. You know, that part isn't that heroic, you know, like, it's understandable. You know, probably most of us, that's how we would do it. And we hear this interesting detail of the Jesus feels his power draining from him. That's kind of a weird little moment. And then she becomes a hero. Because after approaching Jesus in fear and trembling and sneaking a touch, when Jesus gets up and says, who did this? Who touched me? She says, it was me. Now think about that. She had started off hoping just for a mere touch and was frightened to even ask Jesus' touch. She was going to steal it from him. To accepting the consequences of her actions, accepting responsibility by standing up in front of the crowd, in front of Jesus, saying, yeah, it was me. Wow. Now there's a hero for you. She must have wondered, I've angered him. And yet I will say, yeah, it's me. And Jesus confirms, yeah, you are the hero. Your faith healed you. And I'm wondering, obviously the bleeding malady has been healed, but also what that had done to her as a person has also been healed. She would have been a person who at the best would have dealt with the pity of her community. And there was a, she would have been a person identified by her disease. Yeah. That's Joe the fisher. Yeah, that's Joe the farmer. Oh, and that's what's her name, the bleeder. That's how these communities worked, you know, like, you know, you identify with nicknames and the like. I wonder what her nickname will be after this. So what is Mark saying about this? What is Mark saying what it means to be a hero? Heroes change the world. The question is, how do they change the world? In the old days and today, you change the world by leaving your name behind. You do something, you attach your name, and you know people will remember you. And it's interesting, in the ancient Greeks had the concept of being a hero, and you could be remembered for doing really terrible things. Like one of the most bizarre stories I remember hearing is there was a Greek Olympian in the ancient Greek world, and he had not won this prize, I think it might have been the Olympics at the time. And he was so angry, he went into a school building of the time and demolished it, killing a whole bunch of kids. The town struggled with some, I think it was plague or something like that. And so they went to the oracle and said, what do we do? And the oracle said, you have to build a sanctuary in honor of this Olympian. What? He killed a bunch of our kids. Yeah, but you'll remember him. You know, we have a tendency to remember. We remember terrible people, like, you know, serial killers and all this kind of stuff. By the older definitions, they become heroes because we remember their name. What Jesus wants us to be is the kind of hero who will change the world. We might not necessarily leave our name behind. The deeds that we do to make the world a better place, the healings that we're part of, the acknowledgement of those healings, those moments of change in a person's life, we may not leave our name behind. We may have no clue about what we are doing. Through a casual conversation, a moment of concern, an act of prayer. But those are the heroes who will change the world for the better. The world is waiting for heroes who are willing to leave the comfort of waiting for someone else to be the hero. You may watch the news and you watch a story about some, you know, like a great philanthropist or something like that, and you say to yourself, oh, I wish I could be that good. You don't have to be that good. You don't have to go out and spend billions of dollars or whatever making people's life. Just go out and say hello to someone. Once it's socially distant safe and all that kind of stuff to do, give them a call instead, email them, text them. To be the heroes who are willing to encounter the lost and broken in this world and invite them to embrace the wonder of being loved by God. That's what it means to be a hero in today's world. Well, that's what it should mean to be a hero in today's world. Because that's what the world needs. Good people, caring people, compassionate people, and people who do this with joy in their hearts. knowing that they're part of the kingdom of God, a kingdom revealed through an act of healing, and a kingdom revealed through someone having the strength to accept the consequences of their actions and proclaim good news that God is with us. Amen. At this time, we remember in our offering segment the life of the church, the life of the congregation. We give thanks for the multitude of witnesses who are constantly part of our operations here at Strathearn, our worship team, the way it changes, to keep in the mind of the folks who are away for time and the like. We especially remember Catherine, who has taken some time off, and we're grateful for the work that she has been part of, and we're grateful for the folks who are here today. And for everyone, especially those who do their labor in this church in the mid of high summer, because this place gets a little warm. I'm very grateful for the folks who brought me a fan in the office, because I now kind of got that fan right in my back, so it kind of keeps me, I don't know if it'll keep the computer cool, but it keeps me cool. So as always, a reminder of gratitude for the witness of the folks who are the life of our church. Let's just take a moment and prepare ourselves for prayer. God, we give you thanks. We give you thanks for the promises of summer. We give you thanks for all who have labored long and hard during this COVID-19 pandemic. We know that there's still work to be done, vaccination still to be given. We hope that the light of the tunnel is getting closer, but we pray that we continue to be vigilant, to be caring for one another, not to let that care slip because we think we're at the near of the road. If we continue to care for one another with an abundance of caution, we'll ensure that we get closer to that light. We give thanks for all who labor. We give thanks for the presence of God in our lives, the heroes we know, the heroes of faith, the heroes of compassion, the heroes of care. And in silence, O God, we bring these names to you and give thanks for their witness amongst us. God, we pray. We pray for our nation in Canada, a nation that has been confronted with the legacy of its past. We hear of more discoveries of unmarked graves, of Indigenous children, victims of the residential school system. God, give our nation strength and compassion in these times. God, give us the wisdom to remember this was not a Catholic problem. This was a Canadian problem. This was a result of the actions of the federal government and all the main churches of the time. We are all complicit. Complicit in terms of legacy. So as a nation, we pray for strength, wisdom, to listen, to lament, to accept judgment. Only through accepting judgment and lament will we be ready for the next step, which is hope. Hope of reconciliation. Reconciliation that can only come in the terms of the Indigenous people. That is why we pray for strength. The strength to let go of our desire to control the process. We face difficult days, there will be more discoveries. So God, we pray that you be with us. We pray for our leaders of nations to have the strength and compassion to be effective in the face of COVID-19, to govern wisely, to take care of the people that they have been entrusted with. We pray for wisdom and compassion that we share the bounty of vaccines with other nations who do not have our resources, who yet have the same needs as us, to take care of their people in this face of COVID-19. We pray for all who face economic uncertainty in these days, hoping for normalcy, yet fearful that might not come. We pray for all who struggle in the face of oppression based on race, sexuality, gender, belief. We pray that they find justice and compassion in their cries out to be heard, acknowledged, and respected. We pray for the church, that we turn our back on the pursuit of power and pandering and embrace the hope of the kingdom of God, a vision of radical love, where the only judging that is done by God. And in God's eyes, we are all worthy of being judged, and yet all worthy of being touched by grace. And so, God, we come to you with the prayers of our hearts for those who we know are alone, those wounded in mind, body, and spirit, those ill in mind, body, and spirit, those who yearn for connection. In silence, we bring these names to you, O God. Amen. Our closing hymn is May the God of Hope Go With Us, Voices United 424. That's 424. May the Christ who walks on wounded feet walk with us on the road. May the Christ who serves with wounded hands stretch out our hands to serve. May the Christ who loves with a wounded heart open our hearts to love. May we see the face of Christ in everyone we meet, and may everyone we meet see the face of Christ in us. Amen.